Shall I start? Okay. All right, so it's a pleasure for me to give this talk to the Institute and to this workshop. I attended many of the talks. Unfortunately, I couldn't attend all of them. More significantly, I am really sad that I couldn't come to the workshop. I have been missing workshops for almost 2 years now. So it's a real problem, but we do what we can. And I also would have liked to be in Florence and in Arcetri. Even these are beautiful places and with great people. Okay, so this is I'm going to talk about duality in condensed matter and high energy physics. And this is work that I did for the past 2 or 3 years with two really bright students, now former students, Hart Goldman, who's the picture on the left, who's now a postdoc at MIT, and Raman Sohal, who's on the right, and he's now a postdoc at Princeton. Okay, so let me move on now. So let's talk about duality. There are many things that go under the name duality. I will mention those that are more relevant to this talk. Of course, there is the old and familiar version of duality that goes under the name of electromagnetic duality, going back perhaps at least to Dirac, who noticed that there is a symmetry in Maxwell's equations between the electric and the magnetic field, the absence of matter. But if you add a monopole charge and a monopole current, then there is a perfect symmetry of exchanging electric and magnetic fields and exchanging electric charges with magnetic charges. And this led to the famous Dirac quantization, which in natural units is the electric charge times the magnetic charge is 2 pi. Okay, times an integer in general. Okay. Now, there is also another duality that is well known in statistical mechanics that goes back to the work of Kramers and Wanier in 1941 in the context of two-dimensional Ising model, which essentially relates a two-power series expansions for the partition function, one at low temperatures where you count domain walls, and the domain walls have the form of loops in two dimensions, as shown in this figure. Whereas in high dimension, the partition function has a representation also in closed loops, shown on the right. It has a different character. So for instance, the partition function for the domain walls, the natural expansion parameter, as shown here, is e to the minus 2 over t, because essentially it counts the energy per unit length of the domain wall, whereas in the high temperature expansion is this other representation. Can you see this the arrow that I draw when I point to something?
Yes.
Okay, that's my point. So these two partition functions are equal to each other for the, in the case of the Ising model, which is given here. And this essentially maps high temperature to low temperature and disorder in terms of order. So the disorder phase is mapped into the order phase. The order parameter of the Ising mode becomes a disorder parameter in the other phase, in the high temperature phase, and vice versa. So there is a perfect duality or self-duality in the case of the Ising mode. These ideas were essentially extended to all theories with an abelian symmetry group, pretty much, particularly in two dimensions, but also in all dimensions. And in two dimensions, this gives rise to this, to the Costa-Lis-Tauler transition, etc. In three dimensions, this and higher, these ideas were extended for the case of the Z2 symmetry group by Franz Wegener back in 1971. Where he noticed that, say, in three-dimensional classical problem, the low temperature expansion is an expansion in surfaces, random surfaces, whereas the high temperature expansion continues to be an expansion in loops. it turns out, and this is what Wagner showed, well, he didn't quite call it that way, that the dual of the ICMO is not a theory with a global symmetry, but it's actually a theory with a local symmetry, the Z2 gauge theory, which is the simplest lattice gauge theory there is. So in this case, loops are dual to closed loops are dual to closed surfaces, and order is essentially the dual of confinement in this case. So this actually has been extended by a lot of people in many directions. Here I'm presenting the duality in some sense as a Euclidean path integral, which is the classical position function. There is a Hamiltonian version of that that I developed with Lenny Susskind back in 1978, but is not. I prefer not to discuss that version today. Now, in three dimensions, there is an old additional duality known as particle vortex duality, which in a sense is an extension of the ideas of Kosterlitz and Thales to three dimensions. This goes back to work by Peskin, also by my colleague Mike Stone, he was a student, and a little later by Dasgupta and Halperin. These things were done between 1978 and 1981. So the particle vortex duality is essentially used for theories with a global U1 symmetry, such as the 3D classical Exponent model, which is a theory of a superfluid. In the high temperature phase, you get a gas of closed loops, much like in the case of the Ising model. And the loops correspond to the world lines, is interpreted then as a world line of particles and antiparticles, which are created spontaneously out of the vacuum. Whereas in the low temperature phase, is essentially a gas of vortex loops. With an interaction, you may call it Biot and Savart, so it's essentially like the interaction of currents of charges. And this actually gives rise to the notion of particle vortex duality. The most detailed version of the duality was actually done in a more physical way by Dasgupta and Halperin in 1981.
I'm sorry, Eduardo.
Yes.
Can we make an experiment? Why don't you try to be closer to the computer?
Because I need to be close to my iPad as well. Can you hear? Can you not? You cannot hear me?
No, because the quality of the audio is not very good. So I was wondering whether if you are closer to the computer.
Okay, let me use the other microphone, and then I will have I will not hear you. But
no. I mean, just like this, but maybe closer.
I am as close as I can, essentially.
Okay.
It's not possible to understand me. Can you understand what I
say? I think now is better.
Okay. Well, maybe the problem is sometimes I look down, but. Okay, so this is the idea of particle vortex duality. So it's a duality between the vortex loops in the low temperature phase, or weak coupling phase, you may call it, and the high temperature phase, which is the loops of particle antiparticle pairs that are created spontaneously. Now, the quote field theory picture of this. And this actually was almost like this, written down by Halperin and Dasgupta, but not quite. This is a reinterpretation of their work. So in the, let me call theory A, which is the original theory of the superfluid, is a charged scalar field, let me call it phi, coupled to a background gauge field, denoted here by A. So A is a background gauge field, the electromagnetic field, you may say. And it has the usual form, written actually now in the Minkowski signature. So that's why I have these minus signs. Bernheim square is positive, you are in the disorder phase. In other words, you see the loops of charge. And when m squared is negative, you're in the spontaneously broken phase, and you have the loops of vortex loops. In theory B, on the other hand, you have again a charged scalar field coupled to a dynamical gauge field. And notice that in this case, I have here, which I will draw later, a Maxwell type term to that. But the coupling to the background gauge field, it has this dual form, as shown here. And that dual form means that the current of the original problem essentially is the curl of the dynamical gauge field. So in other words, the dual of this of the XY model is actually a theory that has a dynamical gauge field coupled to a dynamical matter field. So it's like a superconductor coupled to a dynamical to the thermal fluctuations of the electromagnetic field. That's how Halperin and Dasgupta actually presented their work. And there you can see that the duality is perfect between the two phases. So in the unbroken phase, you map the unbroken phase of Higgs phase A to the Higgs phase of phase B. In other words, the regime where the superfluid essentially condenses and screens the electromagnetic field, and the broken phase of A to the unbroken phase of B in wavelengths. So there is a critical point associated with this phase, with these theories. Essentially, in each one of them is called the Wilson-Fisher fixed point associated with that. And the Wilson-Fisher fixed point of one theory maps into the Wilson-Fisher fixed point of the dual theory. But the important thing is now the coupling to the background field in theory B has this dual version represented by this term over here. So these ideas essentially were more recently means beginning something like 5 years ago, had a rebirth, partly with interest from people in the high energy community, like Cyborg and Witten, and also people in the condensed matter community, well, one being Son, who is sort of in both communities, and by Santil and Metlitsky and others, and Vishwanath as well. So the idea was to generalize this. There is a particle vortex duality, which I just discussed, that maps bosons to bosons. Okay. There is also another duality that maps fermions to bosons. You may call it bosonization. An early version of that actually was proposed in this paper here that I wrote with Fidel Shaposnik back in 1994, where we did sort of a partial process of this. We basically calculated the effective action for the dual theory and showed that, in fact, the current has this particular dual form and has been sort of perfected by in this theory that back in 2016 by all these people. Okay. So in that case, the Dirac fermion actually maps into a monopole in the dual theory. So that's the duality now. And independently, there was work by Son, inspired by something we'll discuss in some detail today, which is the physics of the quantum Hall effect in the compressible regime. In other words, when the quantum Hall effect is not seen. and by Metlitsky and Vishwanath, also in 2016. So these are very, and these were all conjectures. So the proposal there was that is a fermion-fermion particle vortex duality. So it maps a theory of fermions with a background gauge field A, but there is an anomaly which is related to the parity anomaly that needs to be cancelled if you want to be at if you want to have a time reversal invariant system in the representation of Metlitsky and Vishwanath, as the canceling term or the counter term was provided by a higher dimensional bulk, such as that of a three-dimensional topological insulator in that case. And the dual of that is, again, is a theory of Dirac fermions, such as the one described here, coupled to a dynamical gauge field. I have two different gauge fields, A and B, essentially, simply because I need to make sure that the level of the Chern-Simons terms, which are, for example, written here, so this is essentially the anomaly term, but these terms will have to have a correct quantization. So you can actually write something more economical, but then some people will complain because it would seem that my dynamical gauge field will have a fractional level. So this is more correct or more cautious, if you wish. And here in the last term, let me actually, I don't know if you can see that. In the last term, which is here, is precisely the coupling to the background gauge field, and you can see has again the dual form, the dual version of this. This theory is usually called QED3 by an abuse of language, in a sense. Abuse of language because in practice I should have added the corresponding Maxwell terms which are dropped here.
Sorry, Eduardo, I have a question.
Yeah.
So the ADA on the right-hand side, does it inhabit fractional level? You have a 1 over 8 pi.
Yeah, this is because of the, is precisely the anomaly part, essentially, but it's correct with this. Okay. So this is the term that cancels the anomaly that comes essentially from, if you want, the free Dirac fermions.
Okay, I see. So if the mass, if you integrate out the fermion, then you will get a integer level for the ADA.
Yes, you do. And so you can check in this case, you have the phase transition. This is basically a theory of the phase transition between a trivial insulator and a Chern insulator, if you want, with charge, with sigma, with Hall conductance equal to 1.
Okay.
So this actually was shown by all these people. Okay, so this is, okay, so that's the interpretation. You can think of these as counter terms coming from a higher dimensional bulk. In a lattice model, this actually is provided by the heavy so-called fermion doublers that you always have when you try to put the Dirac equation on the lattice. You always have doubling by the Nielsen-Ninomiya theorem. And if these doublers are heavy, they provide this for these additional counter terms. So that's another way to think about it. In the case of Son, this was less clear, because in a sense it's really presumably coming from the bulk, from essentially the bulk compressible state, but this, it wasn't clear in the way he presented it why this was correct. But in the both in Metlitsky and Vishwanath, where it was essentially a form of anomaly inflow that they invoked, and in this other, in the lattice version where it comes from the doubler, you can see that these terms have to appear if you need to want to have a theory which is explicitly time reversal invariant. Of course, the two-dimensional electron gas in a uniform magnetic field is not time reversal invariant, so you don't worry too much about that because you know it has to have a Hall conductance. Okay, so in general dimension, this type of dualities often map theories with different character and different symmetry. So for instance, there is until today no viable version of this in higher dimensions. So except for the bosonic case where the dual theory is some sort of BF theory with a two-form, essentially with a two-form gauge field. And this has been known for ages, essentially since the work of Savit and others back in 1978 or thereabouts, back in the lattice gauge theory community. But the fermionization, the fermionic dualities, and all of that are not known until today. Okay. Now, at the level of duality, in four dimensions, for instance, you know, a gauge theory dual is the dual of a gauge, is of a gauge theory, but there are many other dualities. So one thing is that it's important, at least in this, for this abelian systems with abelian symmetry, the dualities actually involve two conceptually different dualities. One is the duality of forms, which essentially tells you that in three dimensions, one form is dual to itself, essentially, if you wish, or the current is dual to a gauge field, or the vector potential is dual to a theory with a local symmetry, is dual to a theory with a global symmetry in that case. But in four dimensions, essentially tells you that a two-form is dual to a two-form, and that's the self-duality, for example, of the Ising-Gauge theory in four dimensions, and so on. But there is another duality that is actually enters and is only correct for abelian groups, is the duality of the groups themselves, that the representations of abelian groups form groups as well, whereas this is not true for non-abelian groups. And for this reason, it's hard to extend these ideas in a simple way for the non-abelian case, except unless you use supersymmetry. Nevertheless, there are a number of conjectural dualities, at least in 2 plus 1 dimensions, that work quite well, and I will use them today. So there's also the famous gauge gravity duality, or ADS-CFT. There is this duality, the S and T duality in string theory, where S duality is morally related to the particle vortex duality used here. And then there is a conjecture web of dualities in 2 plus 1 dimensions. And in particular, can one derive this? And with Hart-Goldmann, we provided the scheme for deriving this. So let me go over that very quickly. So we will use a generalized loop model near a critical point, but still in the gap phases. The generalization of the particle vortex duality will appear naturally here, as you will see. We will consider loop models in 2 plus 1 dimensions only. And the loops, we will assume, cannot intersect. And this is actually essential in the essential assumption, which is often not emphasized. Otherwise, the notion of linking number doesn't make sense. And we're going to include phase factors associated with the linking numbers of the particles. We need to make sure to frame the loops, so the loops need to be defined with the framing. And in order to include the self-linking number and the very phase factor associated with the evolution of the frames. And this actually gives rise to the fractional spin. So this is actually what's behind the fermion, the bosonization duality, if you wish. So what are these loop models? They're partition functions, essentially over a gas, for a gas of loops, represented here by these integer valued currents that I have here. These are the loop configurations, which are closed. And so they are conserved currents. And again, I'm going to assume that they don't cross. The conservation essentially is shown here is this delta function constraint. And the Gibbs weight has a real part, an imaginary part. The real part essentially penalizes large loops. So you see a weight for your per unit length plus interactions. So that's the first term. And the second term is precisely the term. So it's essentially a sign related in the and the phase that I drew that I have here, this phase phi, includes both the linking number of the loops of particles and antiparticles as well as the self-linking number and the very phase associated with the frames. Okay, so let me actually concentrate on these phase fields, on these phase terms, which are more significant. So here is a frame loop, shown here by a local frame. So it has a piece that is tangent, one of the axes always tangent to the local loop. And there are two orthogonal directions, and this thing actually will move and and precise as you go around. So that represents precisely the self-linking part, the so-called rise, as you will see in a moment. So it gives you the first term gives you the linking of two different loops. Okay, so that comes from the linking number here. And on the other hand, you're going to have, so this actually appears with a factor of two because it's the mutual linking that enters there. And there are two factors, W of L1 and W of L2, that correspond to the self-linking, essentially, here. And with something which is called the twist. And the two of them together gives you something called the rise. And this terminology actually comes from studies of DNA, as it happens, which was actually in that context that people first presented the notion of long loops, like DNA molecules, that essentially can actually present a rise as they evolve. So what is the twist? The twist essentially represents the evolution along the loop of the frame. So here it is this term. So there are there's a tangent vector, which is here. And these are the other two vectors, which are orthogonal to each other. And so as you evolve, this actually represents the twist factor with the conventional factor of 2 pi that they have here. Now, this quantity, the twist, is not actually quantized, and it does depend on the metric in the embedding space where the loop lives. So you have to think of this as a very phase of the frame. And this term is essential to get the Fermi statistics later, as you will see. Okay, on the other hand, the mutual linking, the linking number between loops L1 and L2, has a natural expression as an expectation value in Chern-Simons theory. So if you introduce a vector field A mu here, and you compute an expectation value of a Wilson loop for the union of these two loops, will give you a Chern-Simons term. And sorry, from Chern-Simons theory, then you will calculate, you will get precisely this term, which essentially is a linking number, and this is a topological invariant. I am assuming here an abelian theory at level k, so it's U1 level k. Okay, so this is the action. And k has to be an integer for this theory to be globally well-defined. So this goes back to the beautiful paper by Witten in 1989, where of course the focus was in an abelian theory. Okay. This is a special case of that. Now, more or less at the same time as Witten wrote his paper in 1989, Polyakov actually proposed a form of bosonization, if you wish. It was incomplete, but it was basically correct. So he related essentially the partition function of a free fermion, a free Dirac fermion with a certain mass in the massive phase, with that of a gauge of a scalar field, a charged scalar field, coupled to a dynamical Chern-Simons term. What I'm doing here, which Polyakov didn't do, are two things. One is, for some reason, he wanted to have two scalar fields, and it's not really necessary. And the other is I am adding the coupling to the background field. But the bulk of the issue that was actually solved by Polyakov is the role of these linking numbers, essentially, or in particular, getting the correct weight for this, which actually gives rise precisely to the fermionic, to the Dirac structure. Okay, so then you represent the determinant, the fermion determinant, can be represented formally as a partition function over a history of some loops. So you can do that. There's a loop representation of that. The loops have to be conserved, so they have to be closed. much like as we did before. But the weight has two factors. One factor is this term here for a free fermion is all you need, that gives you the partition function for loops of just by giving a weight per unit length associated with mass. And there is a phase factor with a phase of pi and a sine that depends on the mass, multiplying this precisely this phase that we discussed before, which has a self-linking and the spin factor. It has both of them, and the mutual linking as well. Okay, so that theory, it turns out that you can show, and I'm going to walk you through that, is equivalent to a theory of bosons. So the partition function of the scalar field, of the charged scalar field given here, has now this form. You can also write it as a theory of loops, but the loops now are coupled to dynamical gauge fields. We have to sum up the histories of the gauge field as well. And so you're going to have essentially a penalty for large loops, essentially coming from the mass, essentially, of this particle that you have here. And there will be a phase factor. And the phase factor is now a little more complicated than before, but it turns out that at least the leading terms are easy to write. So there is a term, essentially, which has this form. Okay, so it's J.A. that tells you that the currents have to be coupled to the gauge field by minimum coupling. There is a coupling to the background gauge field. And there is a level one Chern-Simons term, and this was actually in Polyakov. And then you need an additional term at level one for the background field. If you integrate out a little a here, then you can see that this partition function becomes simple, actually. All you get is the usual j dot a with the external vector potential, and you get the phase factor that you wanted, and you get a contribution, essentially, which looks like a contribution to a Hall conductance. In other words, a Chern-Simons term for the background field at level one that actually is going to cancel a term. So done in this form, you need to start, this is the partition function, you need to add a term associated with the anomaly, and this wasn't in Polyakov. And here is for the case of negative mass. If I want to have this in this regime, I want to have the theory to be time reversal invariant, then I need to have this counter term. We write this half integer level, which is not entirely correct. It's actually the eta invariant, which is non-local, but it's shorthand for the eta invariant, what we write. So the partition function, then, with this term, essentially, for free fermions with this anomaly canceling term factor here, then can be written in this form, as shown here. And it looks like the partition functions I had before, except that I need to add this anomaly canceling term. And the action for the fermions, in addition to the real part, now it has the J dot A term, has the part associated with the anomaly, and it has this factor here that is knows about the linking number and the self-linking. Okay, so in order to get the bosonization identity for positive mass, what one does is use the bosonic particle vortex duality first, which relates negative mass and positive mass, and then you combine that with these identities to get the final answer. And so you map essentially a theory which is time reversal invariant, which therefore has a Hall conductance zero, so it's an insulator, to a theory which has a Hall conductance of square root h. Okay.
Eduardo, can I ask a question?
Sure.
Yeah, so Right. So using the loop representation. Oh, sorry. I mean, so first of all, in the ordinary Lagrangian representation.
Yes.
For example, we can use like a single boson field theory describing either the x y fixed point or the multi-critical point by tuning the four boson term, phi four term to zero. So within the loop representation, how do I know which fixed point we are accessing?
You don't.
We don't?
You don't. And let me, you don't, and this is always the case because you need to, okay, in the original, first of all, as I said, this is a mapping between the two faces. I want to be close to the critical point, but I haven't told you what is the theory of, what is the CFT of that fixed point. And in general, we don't know what that CFT is. Even all these conjectures have not solved that problem. Uh-huh. So you may write down all the Lagrangians you want, but until you don't find what is the structure of the CFT, you don't really know precisely what the structure is. In the case of the particle vortex duality, the bosonic particle vortex duality, there was this the proposal by Halpern and Dasgupta, and thank you for the question. I forgot to mention that. They essentially said that because of this, the soft duality, you get a what they call an inverted XY transition. And this actually has been verified numerically by extensive Monte Carlo simulations. But since these fixed points are not perturbatively accessible, you don't really, just writing down the Lagrangian is not sufficient. And the same is true for all of these theories. You notice that these are theories that have gauge fields which are Simons terms in addition to having a phi to the fourth type action. In fact, the theory of phi to the fourth action, we only know to how to access that either using the epsilon expansion or resummation of the epsilon expansion using Pade, Borel, and things of that sort. The actual, more recently, people have done that using the so-called bootstrap. So there is some information now about the nature of this for the ungauged version of those theories. The assumption is that this is still true when you gauge the theories and you have John Simon's terms associated with them. But what is the form of the fixed point, the properties of the fixed point of these gauged scalar fields with John Simon's term, I don't think anyone has ever solved, not even with a bootstrap. So in a sense, these are manipulations that essentially allow you to relate the spectrum of operators in one phase, in one theory, to a spectrum of operator in the dual phase, in the other theory, and vice versa. Have I responded your question?
Yeah, right. Partly at least, but actually, so in the loop representation, is there a parameter that one can tune to show there's a stable phase, there's a critical point, there's a multi-critical point, things like that?
Well, the phase is stable. You can do that because the partition functions are convergent. These expansions are convergent in the phase, so the phases are stable. The critical point is where the loops proliferate.
Yeah. So what about a multi-critical point? So if I just look at the loop representation or loop model, is there a parameter I can tune to show the system has another multi-critical point?
Well, maybe we should discuss this separately. This was partly the motivation of Halpern and Dasgupta. As you know, the problem of a fluctuating of a scalar field of a, if you want this fluctuating superconductor with a fluctuating gauge field, historically was assumed to be a fluctuation-driven first-order transition by the work of Halpern, Lewinsky, and Ma, independently by Coleman and Weinberg. That turns out not to be generally correct, that there is, in fact, a tricritical point in that case. And there is a regime where the transition is first order, but there's another regime where transition is continuous. And how to represent the continuous transition from in this theory was an open problem, and that's why Halpern and Dasgupta were interested in this. So their proposal is that this is a so-called inverted XY transition. The theory of the tricritical pointer, so far as I know, has not been worked out in that case.
Okay, thank you.
But it requires essentially in the loop representation, you have to tune the essentially the energy per unit length of loop. And remember that the loops actually have non-local interactions, okay, yeah, in the embedding space. And those interactions have to do with the condition of no crossing, precisely. So, okay, so there are lots of problems that are being swept under the rug in this, in all of these presentations, but it's important to keep them in mind. Okay, so let me walk you quickly through the fermionic particle vortex duality. Maybe I want to go to applications, which is actually what I wanted to discuss here, is the application of these to problems in fractional quantum Hall states. Okay, so the fractional quantum Hall state, as all of you know, arises in problems where you can have electron gases in confined to two dimensions in external perpendicular magnetic field in regimes of large fields. So you have these beautiful Laughlin wave functions, for example, here. And there are these fractions where the fractional Hall effect is seen for fractional filling. These are the Jane fractions, which are shown here. And I want you to particularly pay attention to the structure of the Jane fractions. They involve two integers, P and S. The usual theory that you need for the Laughlin states have S equals 1. And essentially, 2s is the amount of flux that we attach to a fermion, to an electron, to make a composite fermion in Jane's picture. Okay, so this comes from flux attachment, all of these ideas. So these are the fractions. And the fractions can always have, as you can see, at least in these abelian phases, denominators. But in the limit where this integer p is very large, they converge to 1 over 2s, which has an even denominator. And in that limit, the fractional quantum Hall effect disappears. Okay, so let me let me just skip this part. So let me discuss an important effect that has been known actually experimentally for a long time, that, as I said, in the limit when the Jane fractions actually begin to get to a convergence value, which is 1 over an integer, which is given here, in this limit the average Chern-Simons field cancels the external field. And Halperin, Lee and Reed proposed that this was some sort of Fermi liquid of composite fermions. And this proposal turns out at the phenomenological level explained pretty much all of the experiments that were known at least until the mid-90s. And even today, I would say it's a very successful theory phenomenologically. But it has some problems. This is true at the mean field level that you cancel that, but you have a dynamical Chern-Simons term field coupled to this theory, and that gives you singular forward scattering interactions. There is another problem, which is at least for the case of 1/2, when n is 1. So when you have field lambda level, there is in the limit of a large magnetic field where you can ignore lambda level mixing. In that limit, there is an apparent particle Hall symmetry in the lowest lambda level, and this theory doesn't respect that. Okay, so this was the motivation of a lot of work, but at the experimental level, there was a result that actually has remained mysterious for many years. So people studied this, is particularly work done in Dan Sui's lab by Danny Shahar, who was his student, I believe, at the time, or maybe a postdoc, with the collaboration of two theorists, Shivaji Sondhi and Efrat Shamshoni. And they observed that the experiment in a transport experiment, what you do is you measure the current and the voltage. And if you have a good metal, if you have an ohmic system, the relation between the current and the voltage, as we know from kindergarten, is linear. Right? And this turns out only to be obeyed precisely at this so-called transition between plateaus. But in the fractional regime, you get a current voltage characteristic that looks like that, whereas in the so-called Hall insulator, which is in the dual phase, it looks like this. So there is an apparent symmetry of the IV curves. So in other words, they are symmetric around the critical point. I'm drawing that on purpose. And there is extensive, particularly for, in the case for nu equals 1/4, which is not the half field level, but the quarter field level, there is extensive experimental evidence of the symmetry. And these authors back in the mid-90s proposed that there was this actually was explainable by particle, this mirror symmetry was a manifestation of particle vortex duality. And that interpretation was not universally accepted, but the data is the data, and that's how it looks. You have this mirror symmetry. Okay, so if you apply this condition, the symmetry for general Jane states, it means that the Jane state that looks like this, which is usually called particle-like, and this one that looks is Hall-like, is sort of the dual. For nu equals a half, then you get particle Hall symmetry, but for general values like the ones that converge at 1/4, you don't. But you still have this mirror symmetry. Okay, so let me discuss briefly Sohn's conjecture in this context. So in the case of Sohn, the is nu is 1/2. And in a paper with Hart Goldman, we proposed a generalization of Sohn's conjecture, where we added, so we have essentially here the Dirac fermion coupled to a dynamical gauge field A. But now we're going to add an actual Chern-Simons term. And notice that has fractional levels, which I can take care of this by adding suitable additional fields if necessary. So I'm going to violate some of these principles here just for the sake of brevity. And so you can have a term that from n is 1, which is for nu equals a half, essentially will be cancelled, is this term here, but for general n is not. So for instance, for n equals 2, which is what I need for 1/4, they don't cancel. There is the Sohn-like coupling between the gauge, the dynamical gauge field and the electromagnetic field here, okay, which is written here. And then this is the anomaly cancellation term that it appears in this form. So the curl of large A is the external field, and little a represents flux attachment. So what's the electron filling? Electron filling essentially is you vary the, you compute the expectation value in this theory by varying the Lagrangian relative to the time component of the electromagnetic field. And you divide that by the flux per unit, the flux going through the system. And this quantity can be computed easily. It leads to an effective, depends on the value B star, little B star, which is the curl of the gauge of the dynamical gauge field. If I insist that that number is equal to zero, that there is no flux, then automatically you get one of the compressible fractions. Okay, so the composite fermion, Dirac Fermi surface, now is set by the time component of the dynamical gauge field. And you can ask what is the density of the composite fermions, these Dirac fermions, and you can work it out by varying relative to little a naught, and you get this expression here. So the filling fraction now of the composite Dirac composite fermions is 2 pi times the density divided by the effective flux, and you end up with this result over here. Now, if you assume that the Dirac fermions essentially fill P lambda levels, P Dirac lambda levels, and have filled the zeroth lambda level, then you get automatically the J fraction. On the other hand, if I make a particle Hall transformation, I will map nu psi into the negative of that. And then you get precisely the form of the so-called Hall-like J sequences. So a particle Hall transformation of the Dirac composite fermion is equivalent to the reflection symmetry that we started with. Okay, so how about the soft duality of the transition? We can do that by an extension, so I can do fermion boson duality. If you do fermion boson duality, you can extend that, so you map essentially the fermions to the bosons, and this is the number one, so essentially I use one of my identities that I did before. Again, I have this the fractional levels that by an abuse of notation. And then I follow that by a boson particle vortex duality, which is given in the second line. So if I do two at a time, then essentially you see that this compressible value, the compressible value of the actual physical filling fraction corresponds to a filling fraction of nu phi to be equal to the negative of the dual boson and to be equal to one. And the reflection symmetry, which we see just so it is obeyed, then becomes the same as the boson vortex symmetry. So the boson vortex symmetry, in a sense, tells you that the reflection symmetry at nu equals 1 over 2n is actually the boson soft duality. And this is actually what was conjectured in these original works. Now, of course, in a real physical system, the soft duality is only approximate because, for example, lambda level mixing will always violate this to a finite but actually small amount. And you can achieve the same violation here, for example, if I go back to my theory and I give a mass to my fermions. So if the fermions now have a mass term, then the soft duality that I get will be only approximate. So in a sense, because a very phase is not equal to pi in that case, it's modified. Okay, so if it's 9 o'clock here, so we started a little late, so may I have 5 minutes to discuss something interesting about non-abelian states?
Yes.
Okay. So, okay, well, it is all very interesting, but there are many interesting states that appear, in particular this state at phi halves, which is famous, that we believe is a state with an even denominator, with a fractional quantum Hall state, so it's not describable by any of these theories. And we all believe this is well described by the so-called Moore-Weil or Pfaffian wave function, which is given here. And this actually turns out to be quite interesting because it has among its quasi-particles, the fundamental quasi-particle, which has a charge 1/4, in this case, turns out to be a non-abelian quasi-particle in the sense that it has two fusion channels, and this has been proposed as a possible platform for doing topological quantum computing, although it is not universal. There is a generalization of this, which I don't know if I known as the so-called Reed-Rezai states, where there is a Pfaffian factor, which is normally interpreted as a correlator of Majorana fermions, is replaced by some other CF, by essentially an expectation value in some suitable CFT. In the case of Reed-Rezai, it turns out to be a parafermion CFT, and it has a parafermion, and I apologize for the name because I am partly with Leo Kalanov, who were at fault for their name. So, although the theory that we worked out was in a different regime. So this theory was at the level of CFT, was actually subsequently solved by Zamolodzhikov and Fateyev, and by Gebner and Chu. And this actually is what is being used for constructing these states. One particular case, for instance, for level three here, they are based on ZK parafermions, as it turns out, for SU2 level K. For K equals three, it turns out that the analog of the non-abelian quasi-particle, which has two channels, is known as the Fibonacci quasi-particle. These days, it has the property that it fuses into itself and the identity. Whereas in the case that I discussed before, it has two channels, but the fusion is into other particles, abelian particles, in fact. And for that reason, it's actually, this is interesting because it was shown by people like Michael Friedman and others that this type of quasi-particles could be used to as a platform for universal topological quantum computing. In other words, that you will cover uniformly the Bloch sphere with them. So this is an interesting problem, but it has been one of the difficulties in the case of the Reed-Brzai states is that in addition to this Fibonacci anion, there are many other anions. In fact, it has a host of them. It has a rather rich spectrum, which makes it a very interesting theory. But if you want to make a topological quantum computer, this is a problem because that will contaminate the signal, so to speak. And that happens already in the phi halves case. And this has been seen in the experiments by Willett, for instance. So then we set out with originally with Nayak and Schoutens. We had a proposal which it's basically correct, but it had some problems, and I don't have time today to go over that. But in the recent work with Hart and Raman, we decided to revisit this problem and write down a theory. The simplest version of the theory, let me show you here, it comes here. Essentially, what you want is a theory has only one anion quasi-particle, which obeys the fusion rule of the Fibonacci family. The question is there a topological QFT that actually can do this? A topological quantum field theory? Well, there was a proposal which is correct based on the exceptional group G2 at level one. It makes into a rather arcane and complicated construction for practical purposes. Practical as it practical is for me. It turns out that there is a duality between G2 level one and U2 at level 3,1, which means it's a product of an SU2 level three and a U1 level two, and you need to mod out a Z2 between them. So the theory for the Fibonacci has a Lagrangian so this is our proposal. That looked like SU2 at level three, the level is here. And there is the U1 level two essentially comes by looking at the diagonal part of U2. So this is the SU2 level three is the first term. And this is the U1 level two is written here. And then there is the coupling to the background field, essentially it has this dual form as before, okay? So this theory, for instance, has nu is equal to two. It's a bosonic theory. This is analogous in some sense to the Moore-Reed state for nu, bosons at nu equals one, which is non-abelian. In this case, it's two. Okay, so we have, so what you do here is you say, well, let me start with the theory of the Dirac fermions, say three layers, which in this case were identical. I'm going to give you an alternative version in a moment. And we want to have three Diracs close to the transition between nu equals two and nu equals one. These are integer Hall states. So you write down the three Dirac's with the associated terms canceling the parity anomaly as we did before. And you can do this for any number of layers, but let me do this for the simplest case, which is here. And then the dual bosonic version we can write is here. And then I do what I'm going to call clustering. In other words, I'm going to couple, essentially condense pairs of these bosons between these pairs of layers, and they overlap with each other. And so you end up with this condition, because there are three of them, that you bump up the level one transimons to a level three transimons, which you want. But in particular, you end up precisely with this Lagrangian, which has the desired property. Okay, so this is in this case, this particular condensate is actually what plays the role of the Fibonacci in this theory. Now, there is an alternative version of constructing this, which is actually physically simpler. So you begin with three layers. The middle layer is going to be a bosonic Halperin state 2-1, which essentially has two species and essentially has an SU2 symmetry in it because of the structure. It's a Halperin 2-1 state. And then it has a filling fraction here. And the other two are essentially integer at filling fraction -2, the surrounding layers. So layers 1 and 3 essentially are, in some sense, are trivial. This is the new equals -2 that they have here. But the middle layer actually has this form. So this is the theory of the Halperin state. So there will be a transition between this 2-1 state to a Fibonacci state. So there is a quantum phase transition when there is no clustering. In other words, when you don't pair these layers, then when this expectation value is zero, then essentially you're in this regime here. And you see the Halperin state 2-1. But in the other regime, you see precisely the Fibonacci state that one wants. And one of the things we did, based on this effective Lagrangian that we wrote here, we proposed a wave function for the Fibonacci state. So I wanted to flash this in my last transparency. Even though in this particular case one is not interested in the phase transition, you can see that this type of effective field theories, if you wish, even in the bulk, can be used to motivate new and interesting types of fractional quantum Hall fluids, in particular ones that will have a Fibonacci state, which is the golden state that one would like to have for topological quantum computing. Yeah, so let me stop here.
Thank you.
Should I stop the share?
Wait. Maybe they want to ask a question.
Yes, no, I know. Okay. I want to see people. That's it.
Okay. Well, at the back, unfortunately, there is a question.
Okay.
By Paul Wigman.
I can use this stuff, right? Personal. Hi, Eduardo. This is Paul Wigman. Hi.
Hello. Your voice, I don't see you, but I know it's you.
Okay. Yes, it's a chance to say hi. I see the, Chilean lake behind you, right?
It's not Chilean, it's Argentinian.
Argentinian lake.
Chile is behind the mountain, behind that glacier. Right at the border, essentially.
I have a question about your slide, which expressed Jane sequence If you can go back to that slide, it will be easier for me to ask a question.
So this is my version of a Blackboard talk, you realize that.
Yeah, so yes, it's also, yeah, is this one? Yes, this okay, one? Doesn't matter. Yes, for example, this one. Okay, so my question is, suppose nu is one third.
Yes.
Or simply one over integer number, some familiar, the most, the main series.
Yes.
Then I have Laughlin wave function.
Yeah.
And from Laughlin wave function, with certain effort, I may compute structure function, which is a correlation function between two densities, right? I yes. take Laughlin wave function, fixed square it, fixed two points, integrate over all others, go to Fourier space.
Yes.
And that object is called structure function,
right?
Function of momentum, and I can compute expansion in powers of this momentum and small momentum.
Yes.
And we know at least three coefficients because it's based on some rules, and those yes. coefficients are functions of fraction. Okay, so my question is, if I take more complicated Jane fraction, probably on the previous slide.
Yes. Any of the other ones, you mean?
Yes.
You mean like this?
Yes. This is this formula. Yeah. So with this complicated, more complicated fraction, do you think that the structure function will be still analytic function of fraction, or it will reflect arithmetical structure of the fraction like this formula suggests?
The answer is, okay, this, what I did here today is, doesn't fully address that problem. You know that in order to make these states from this theory, I need to put, I need to have a chemical potential, if you wish, away from the neutrality point of the Dirac fermions. And this is much like what Sohn does in particular. In that limit, certainly for the simple case of the Laughlin states, you will end up certainly with the leading term given correctly by these expressions. Of the density-density correlation function, that's guaranteed by translation, invariance, and Galilean symmetry. And in fact, I did that with Ana Lopez a long time ago. So that's one of the things that you do recover. Mm-hmm. The higher order terms, I don't think anybody has ever tried to compute them from, in particular for, say, for example, for the two-fifth state already. Mm-hmm. It's complicated. I'm not sure if the Stockholm group, you know, Hans Hansen and his collaborators actually had proposals for these wave functions, which are rather complicated. And I'm not sure if they calculated these higher order terms. What we did do with Hurt, with my student Hurt, or then student Hurt, is we calculated the expected values of the whole viscosity, and we get the correct values that you will get from a wave function analysis. So I would imagine at least those coefficients that are related to the whole viscosity should come out correctly if you do this systematically, but we haven't done it.
Mm-hmm.
But even from a wave function point of view, I don't think anyone has ever computed those things. Mm-hmm. These higher fractions, essentially.
Mm-hmm. The reason why I'm asking is, if you move one slide to slide 18, yes, so the Lagrangian, which you suggested, this slide suggests is... Does it rely on arithmetics, right? It's heavily reliant on arithmetic.
No, two plus two is also relies to arithmetic. but this is more than that. There is duality here. And here we looked in particular the case about, you know, how these particular fractions are realized. It's, in a sense, the you need to require that this the flux that the composite fermion C vanishes, essentially, which is that condition. But we haven't calculated any dynamical property beyond the whole conductance here. We calculated, as I said, and we checked that, the whole viscosity, which is another essentially universal property if the fluid is uniform. But it's a property of interest. But we have not calculated from this theory any of these more detailed response functions, like the one you're actually asking me to compute, the density correlators in particular. They are interesting. I'm not saying they are not, but no one has ever done it. Not even actually from this point of view, not even for the one-third state using, say, Hilson's approach.
Thank you.
Okay.
More questions? Okay, if there are no more questions, we thank again the speaker.
Okay. I wish, as I said, that I would have been there. Okay.